Is it a fight? Yes, but Jesus told us, fight the good fight of faith. Fight the good fight of faith, because you now have at the right hand of the Father an advocate, an intercessor, a lawyer, a surety, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, who will fight for you through every battle if you just give Him, if you give Him your heart.
Is your body falling apart? If you're losing your mother to cancer, you need her to be healed. You know what you need? You need the gift of faith. Extend yourself. Push past the barriers. Believe God with all your heart and push into that area where only God can take you. And when you do that, then the gift of faith will take you the rest of the way and you'll see a miracle.
Greetings in the precious name above all names, Jesus Christ. In Romans 10:17, the word declares that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. On behalf of Pastors Wayne and Mary Ann Berry of John 3:16 Christian Center, we are truly thankful you have decided to set apart time to watch the Faith for Today broadcast. We know that your faith will grow and develop because of your decision to listen to God's holy word. Let us now go together and watch another life-changing message.
In your Bibles, this series of messages, I'll reiterate a little bit, the series of messages is to help us to understand where God has brought us, what we used to be like, and what we are now. But it also enables us to understand what kind of people we're dealing with when we're meeting someone from the world. Why sometimes it seems like it's so difficult to get through their thick head that you're trying to save their miserable hide. Amen?
Amen.
Ever been that way? Ever deal with someone just simply hard-headed, just stubborn? Well, it's because... No, never saw that. God puts up with an awful lot when it comes to human beings. John chapter 10, verse 10 says, the thief, that's who?
Satan.
Satan. The thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, and destroy. So we know what Satan does. He steals, kills, and destroys. But Jesus says, but I have come that you might have life. That word life, I said, was the Greek word zoe. And I said that that word zoe life refers to the God kind of life. We just sang about it in this last song. Fill me now with your healing power. Fill me now with the life of God. All right? Zoe life. God kind of life. And I said, and the better way to understand it is this way, is that zoe life is the life that keeps God alive. God is an eternal God. You can't kill God. They tried to. They nailed him to a cross. They stuck a spear in his side. They put 39 lashes on his back, blood pouring and gushing from every cell in his body. But they couldn't kill God. Why? Because he has zoe life. God kind of life, life that keeps God alive, eternal life. Jesus says, I have come to give you life. He was telling the people at that point in history, he was telling them, I've come for a purpose. I've come to show you that life eternal does exist, and I have it, and I've come to give it to you. Well, that was a lot of amens. God invaded mankind of life, so that human could have this absolute eternal life. When human, as I've been talking about, requires this zoe that God offers him, he becomes a new creature. When he gets this zoe life, he becomes a new creature altogether. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. The old creature has passed away. He's become a new creature. What made him new? This new life made him new. This new kind of life made us eternal creatures. So, how many here are saved? If you're saved, and you have accepted Christ as Savior and Lord, then you have already possessed eternal God kind of life. It's not something that we're looking forward to get. Like in the Old Testament, they were looking forward to get this life. Jesus made the announcement, the reason I'm here is to give you what you've always wanted, eternal life. So he came to give mankind of life, eternal life, and now we're a totally different species of man. A born-again Christian is someone who has a totally different kind of life. Yes, we look the same on the outside, all right? But Jesus is at work on the inside, all right, to do something for us on the outside. You know that old song? Jesus on the inside, he's working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my life. Huh? Yes, yes. Human became a new species. Totally different new species of man. He's a God, he became a God-man. We have been so religiousified that when we talk this way, it seems to be repulsive. It's almost like, oh, please don't try to equate me with God. I'm not trying to equate you with God. I'm just simply telling you what the Bible tells us. It has telling us that that's what God's original intent all the time. He made man, as we find in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, he says, made man in his image and after his likeness. He wanted us to be exactly like him, a clone of God. Because man screws up, does that change God's mind? Because you personally screw up, does that change God's mind about you? When you screw up, do you think, well, that's it for you, bozo? Huh? God only hates one thing on earth. He hates sin. Because he knows the destructive power of sin. Sin entered in the world when a man, Adam, decided to disobey God. Other than that, up to that point, there was no sin in the earth. No destructive power in the earth. So man made this decision, God didn't. Man made a decision to leave the place that God had brought him and created him to be exactly like him, and man chose to live, as I said to you, human comes from the Latin word humus, and humus means dirt. So he decided to leave heaven and become like dirt. Would you say, does anybody here believe that, when I say this, that that was a stupid decision? And how many more decisions is man making exactly like that today? Well, we find it, as they say, history repeats itself. Well, it does. Man consistently keeps making these same ignorant choices again and again and again and again and again. Now, what we find is, and we're going to talk about this today, is that even creatures that are now born again and have the indwelling power of Zoe life inside of them are making stupid decisions. I'm not saying ignorant decisions, because if you're born again, you should know better than to make some of the decisions that you're making. And so when you make these ignorant decisions, what you're basically choosing once again, just like Adam is to rather than live like a Zoe man, you've chosen to live like a dirt man. And you know what the strangest thing is that dirt men seem to be having, as some people say, more fun. Do dirt men have more fun than dirt men? It doesn't even equate. Yet for some reason we're attracted to be a dirt man. It's just too early in the morning. God's original intent. God does not change his mind. He had an original intention for us to be like him. And so, because man fell away, that doesn't mean God changed his mind. He just devised a plan to win this dirt man back to him so that he can revert from dirt to eternal once again. But this time, rather than being made, the choice is in the hands of man, not in the hands of God. So man, out of his own free will, chooses every day to either live by dirt or live by eternal life. It's really, I had someone tell me, that life is not that simplistic, Pastor Wayne. It isn't? Some of the most profound things in the Bible are simplistic. We just make it difficult. And why do we make it difficult? Because we don't want to obey. It's that simple. We just simply do not want to obey. You know what? You can do this with your kids. You can find out what man's like just by watching children. Children want to do certain things, and there's other things they do not want to do. And what do parents have to do? Well, if you don't want to do that, dear, that's okay. I don't want to force anything on you. No, you take them and throw them against the wall. Now, we learned last week that when Adam and Eve disobeyed God in the garden, he lost Zoe life. The only life that man has, once you lose Zoe life, the only life that you have left is a life called Suki life. P-S-U-C-H-E, Suki life. And Suki life only allows you to live based on their five senses. Therefore, in Suki life, if you were to eliminate one sense, you have a now less life to live. Some people live a fairly decent life losing one sense. If you lose another sense, now you even lose even more life and less contactability to this natural world. That's what makes people who observe this sort of thing get angry with God, because they're perceiving God from Suki life, life that's based on five senses. No wonder they don't understand this eternal creature called God. They've lost their capability to understand and perceive him. That's why it tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14, that the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. If their spirit is dead, how can they possibly understand that God is a loving God and does not hate any of us, even those that spit in his face and beat his back and nail him to the cross? He loved them as they were doing that. It is a kind of love that Suki does not understand. Can't comprehend. Now, we're going to read a story in the Bible that really the Lord taught what I'm teaching you for the last couple of weeks. He taught this in a very simple manner to a woman at a well. Turn to John chapter 4. And we can see everything that I've been telling you here in just a story form. What happened to this woman describes exactly what I've been talking about. John chapter 4, verse 5. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there, and Jesus therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. There cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus saith unto her, Give me to drink. Give me a drink of water. For his disciples were gone away into the city to buy meat. Now, that little scripture, verse 8, was inserted there because it was important for those who first read this to understand why Jesus would even ask this woman for a drink of water. First of all, the culture was no man asks a woman for anything. You don't talk to women. Number two is, why would a Jew man, who shouldn't be talking to women in the first place, talk to a Samaritan woman? That even more doesn't make any sense. So, why did he ask for this drink of water from her? Because the disciples had gone into the city to buy some meat. Meat referring to solid food. They needed some food. They had nothing to eat. So he sent them into the city, and they went in there, and he sat there by the well. Do you think Jesus knew what he was doing? Then saith the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it that thou, being a Jew, askest drink of me? See, she even knew. What are you doing? You're asking me for water? Which am a woman of Samaria. For the Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. They have nothing to do with Samaritans. Samaritans were people that were despised by Jews. Now this goes back into history for a long, long time. There are various different reasons as to why the Jews despise Samaritans, like you find today with prejudice towards some group of people. You can say, well, why do the people hate this sort of, this kind of person? And you know what? When you go back into history, you find that there's a multiplicity of stupid reasons as to why they get involved with this way. People just will not let it go. They will not let it go. But basically what happened was is that the kingdom of Israel split. There were two tribes that stayed together, Judah and Benjamin, and the rest of them all split and went away into to a country they've referred to as Samaria. And the Samarian area was a place where they reestablished a second kingdom. God's people, but they refused to come to Jerusalem to worship at the temple. So they put Asherah poles into the mountains, and they went up there to worship God on mountaintops. That's why they went bad. Eventually, what happened is the Assyrians came in and conquered them and dispersed them. And through the rest of their empire, that was their methodology. You go to a country, you overtake it, you remove all the people, you take them out of their comfort zone, and you put them into a strange land, and you make them live there. And you put new people into that area where they were once before. And those new people came from some other conquered land, and they then settled that land. Well, the Jews hated Samaritans. Why? Because they had nothing to do with God's chosen people. So there was a great hatred towards Samaritans. And this woman asked Jesus, What are you talking to me for? Jesus answered and said unto her, listen to what he said to her. If thou knewest the gift, say gift. If thou knewest the gift of God, what do you suppose the gift of God is that he was referring to? Life. The very thing that we're talking about. Zoe life. I have come that you might have life. This was a gift. There was no way to get this gift until Jesus came. It was impossible to have eternal life. It was a concept. It was just simply a biblical concept that they talked about, but there was no way to get it. Jesus said, I've come to give you eternal life. If you knew how many people today, 2,000 years later, still don't know that the gift of eternal life is available. You say 2,000 years and people on earth still don't know this gift is available? Something's totally wrong. What in the world has happened? If you knew the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee, give me to drink. If you knew the gift of God and who you were talking to, if you knew that you were talking to the incarnate God, that the God of creation was sitting on Jacob's well asking you for a drink of water. If you knew the full implications of what all of this really is, what would you do then? Would you be asking me these dumb, stupid questions? Oh, Lord. Well, how many of us can put ourselves in the same position as that woman, huh? And how many stupid questions have we ever asked or insinuated to God? If you knew who you were talking to, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have, if you ask, he would have given thee living water. Living water. The woman saith unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing, look at her response, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. It's way down there. The well is deep, from whence thou hast thou living water. How are you going to get this living water? So much of our interpretation of what God speaks to us, whether it be through the word or through prophecy, so much of it is lost because we perceive, because we are psyche. We perceive out of senses. Where's the water? Everywhere we look, there's sand. There's only one place water is. Down there. You don't have anything to get it. Where are you going to get this water? She had no idea who she was talking to, and she had no idea what he meant by living water. Every day you read the Word of God, the profoundness of it all is lost because much of it is perceived through psyche, through your senses. That's why Paul teaches us in Romans chapter 8, not to walk after the flesh. Don't let the flesh be your guiding senses, because flesh only leads to death. Why? Because Suki has a limited lifespan. Suki only knows one thing. I was born and I will die. Somewhere in the middle of those two things, I'm going to live. I hope I live a long life, though I've seen a lot of people live a short life. I'm believing for a long life because I'd like to live a long time and enjoy this Suki. How many know that there's been a lot of people that had a very, very short life but didn't have to live by Suki? Because you live a short life on earth, does that mean you never experience God? We've murdered millions of little babies. Will we pay for that? Oh yeah, we will. A lot of loss will come from it. But you know what? God looks at those little babies, and you know what? They're innocent. So they never had to live by Suki. They've been living by eternal life. In Jeremiah, God was talking to Jeremiah when he first called him to go to be a prophet.
Well, we've run out of time once again. However, before we go, we would like to give everyone the opportunity of inviting Jesus Christ to be your personal Lord and Savior. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you are promised eternal life. The Bible tells us this in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. Let us pray that together right now.
Say, Heavenly Father,
I believe
that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world. He went to hell in my place. He rose from the dead and ascended into heaven. He is my Savior and my Lord. I will serve him all the days of my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord.
We encourage you now to call and share with us the incredible decision you have made. Our number is 845-677-0625. We would like to send you some information on the wonderful decision you have made. If you would like to visit our church family, we encourage you to come to 3112 Route 82 in the town of Unionville. For directions or further information, please visit us on the web at john316cc.org. Until next week, continue to build your faith with God's holy word.